to start with today's session. So today's session is API Management in Istio Service with WSO2 API Manager. And my name is Sanjay Mahagoda, and I'm working as Associate Director of Engineering at WSO2. And also I'm working as open source contributor. I contribute to Open API CodeGen project and some other Apache projects as well. So in this session, what we will primarily cover is what is service mesh, what are the leading service mesh solutions available, why we need service mesh, and what is the importance of having API management in service mesh. And finally, we will have a demonstration which explains you how you can integrate Istio Service Mesh with WSO2 API Manager. Okay, so if we look at on the evolution of applications, then early days we had mainframes and we have one monolith app. And over the time, there were different vendors coming into market, and there were different enterprise applications. And then after some time, there were like department-specific applications, then came SaaS apps, then private and public PaaS become a hot topic. And these days, serverless and microservices have become a very popular thing. So if you look at this evolution of the software, we can see day by day number of endpoints are growing. So as of now, like there are like 50 billion endpoints, and I expect that to go to 1 trillion within next 2 years or so. So when these endpoints grow, we will need to manage them. So API management is very important, and digital transformation is also very important. So discuss this first before moving to the Istio. First, we will look at microservices. Why microservices needed? What are the challenges with microservices and things like that? So, if we discuss why we need microservices architecture, because that basically enables you to have individual components, which allows you to run them, test them, deploy them individually. And also it increases the agility and flexibility, and finally it helps you to go to market very quickly, because one team can develop their component without depending on each other. They can individually develop them, they can individually test them, and finally you can do the integration. And also when we use microservices, it helps us to do the innovation fast. And have small teams with that we will be able to manage software teams easily, and we can practice agile software development methodologies very easily. And also we have freedom to use heterogeneous technologies, and with the microservices architecture we can get the early feedback cycles as well. So if you have big monolith app, until finally something went wrong, we will not know what happened. So with this architecture, when we have a smaller component, we can test them individually and verify their functionalities against the expected things. And also, microservices is a kind of an architectural style which approach develop single applications, which is designed specifically for a specific task. And usually it runs within its own communication, its own process. And usually communicate via lightweight mechanisms. Most of them use HTTP, HTTPS, sometimes DRPC. There are different other protocols that they communicate with each other. So these services are built around the business capabilities. Like I mentioned earlier, they should be automatically deployable. And usually with this architecture, we automate deployment because number of small components grow. So if you take a big monolith application, then you can see, so if you see this diagram, then we will have one monolith application, which has four different business functionalities. So we will have one single application. So whenever we need to deploy, scale, or manage, we have to take entire application and deploy that separately. For example, if we see If we say we get request increase in to circle service, then what we have to do is that we have to take this entire component and scale that. So that is how we were supposed to scale monolith applications. And also, if something went wrong with the circle application, what you have to do is that you have to turn down the entire monolithic app and fix that and deploy that. Likewise, there are different complexities attached to this thing. So then, if we take this monolith app and break that into smaller components, then we will have four different services. So one can be triangle service, circle service. Likewise, we will have different four services. So when we have these four services, we can scale them separately. So for example, if we find the best language that we need to use to implement circle services, Java, probably you can use some Java framework. So it can be different from the triangle service. So for the triangle service, most suitable programming language would be C or C++. So in that case, we can use that language to this thing. And also when it comes to deployment deployment architecture, we can again make independent choices about each of these services. So likewise, now we have four different services which we can develop independently and manage them independently. So when we have scaling requirement or replicated requirements, now we can have different systems with the different requirements. So some scenarios we will have more circle services. So if circle service demand goes high, we can only scale the circle service like you see here. So likewise, we can deploy them independently. So then when we have this microservices, so initially it looks like very promising and it sorts all the deployment issues, all the integration issues and things like that. But when we closely look at it, the microservices, there are some challenges associated with microservices as well. So one challenge is breaking monolith up into the microservices adds more and more components. So when the component count goes high, we will have to maintain them and and also we will have to coordinate among these different services. So that can be complex when this instance count goes high. So let me take one example. Let's say we have some monolith application which is handled billing, payment, listing and some business application which is related to retail selling. Okay. So then if I break that to the microservices, then this would be the microservices that we have. So we'll have a separate front-end app, then the billing would be separate microservices. And for the listing, we will have different microservices, and returns we have different things. For the payment, we will have different microservices. So as you can see here, before we had one monolith application, now we have six different microservices just for this particular shopping application. And now think, if we have multiple applications like that, so you can see, right? I mean, there are a lot of components here and there, and things getting complicated little by little, right? So when we have this kind of situation, we will need to have effective way to manage this stuff, right? So when you have this kind of large number of components, there are different challenges that we have. So one is the secure communication between these services. The one is the analytic tracing and monitoring. And also another challenge would be the disaggregation architecture, increase the number of endpoints. So number of endpoints increase, you have to record them somewhere, you have to have idea, you have to have health monitoring, all these things need to be there. And also communication will be challenge. So service discovery, network resiliency, secure communication, all these services will be challenges. So how this can be solved? So service mesh solutions introduced to cater this requirement. So service mesh is kind of a dedicated infrastructure layer that controls service communication. And also it provides us a way to, you know, manage them separately and scale certain components separately and it will take care about the communication. Some of the service mesh solutions provide us all the details about the service mesh, like how things communicate between services, what are the latencies added by the each and every service, and what are the route paths, what are the analytics, all this information available with some of the service mesh solutions. So if you have a look at all the leading service mesh solutions available today, and these are some of the leading service mesh solutions: Istio, Blue, AWS, AppMesh, Linkerd, and sometimes we had Kenute, and later they made it Linkerd. So these are some of the major service mesh implemented. So out of these service mesh solutions, Istio is one of the leading one. So it's an open source service mesh implementation, which also provides us the behavioral insight and the operation control of the service mesh as support. And so this with the Istio, we can see a lot of people start their develop their services and the service mesh solutions with the Istio. So if we discuss about the Istio component overview, we go to next slide. So this is how Istio component looks like. So like I discussed earlier, we will have different services, and also these services are bind with the proxy, which handles ingress and egress, incoming and outgoing traffic for that particular service. And also this proxy service usually communicate with the mixer. And then we have something called pilot. Let me go to the detail. So mixer is some kind of policy enforcement and access control usage policies, and collect the telemetries. All this information happen at the mixer side. So usually when Onoi gateway get some kind of a call, so we go here, you can see service A bind with the proxy service. So if someone try to call service A, this proxy will call that record, certain information, headers and some other information, and it will inform that information to mixer. So mixer know this kind of request comes. And so this mixer comes with the pluggable adapter architecture. So with this, whenever we get some request to proxy A, which is deployed with the service A, we can handle that in the mixer side. So in the mixer, we will have adapter architecture. So with that, whenever request comes to service A, these adapters get known. So with these adapters, we can do the policy checks. So you can record these events, or you can do anything like that. So that is the primary responsibility of the mixer. And also, if we discuss about this proxy, then they use Onoi as a proxy. So it's a high-performance gateway which handles incoming and outgoing traffic. So next component is the pilot. So pilot basically provide service discovery for the Onoi sidecars, and also it will take care about the traffic management capabilities, intelligent routing, all this information push into Onoi gateways, all this stuff handled by the pilot. So pilot is, you can see pilot in the control plane. So when you need to update proxies or any other component, what you have to do is you have to communicate with the pilot and let pilot to deploy those policies to proxies or the control your entire system. Okay, so next component is the Citadel, which enables you to handle the security, usually service security, authentication, mutual SSL, all this stuff handled by the. So you can see that in this diagram. It will handle the TLS certificates and pass these to proxies, all this stuff handled by them, this Citadel component. So then, this is the overview of the Istio service mesh solution. So with this architecture, you can have any number of, so if you need to scale services, then you can have another block of SA, then pilot will take care about the deployment stuff, and Citadel will take care of the certificate, all this stuff. So likewise, you can scale the component. So then we will see why we need API management in the service mesh solution. So usually, when users expose microservices to outside, they need to have another additional security, and they need to expose those services to outside in a controlled manner. So one requirement would be expose these services to outside in a very secure manner and also a controlled manner. So when we have this kind of requirement, authentication and authorization, access and rate limit, all this stuff need to be handled in the this solution. And also one other important requirement is like have developer portal kind of thing, which allows you to go there and find available services and subscribe to them and start using them. And also there are some use cases around the monetization also prominent when we have this kind of solution. So that is why API management and complete API lifecycle management is very important in the Istio. So if we take Istio current Istio state today, that doesn't have out-of-the-box capabilities, so it need to integrate with the API management solution to handle this requirement. And also steps is very important, because if we take Envoy, then there are Envoy that it will publish certain information to the mixer, and there are different dashboards and other stuff which show this information. But if we analyze them carefully, those are like mainly about the service level communication, or and how network latency added, how processing time added, all this information. So most of the time, it doesn't show you how exact business data. For example, if you have a buying service, it doesn't show how many people use this specific resource within last hour. So how people are going to use your API, how many subscribers are there, how they access, what are the different access types. So all this information need to add on top of the service information to have a proper solution with the API management. And also, if you have a marketplace kind of thing, like I mentioned earlier, then definitely API management solution is needed. So now let me discuss how WSO2 API manager solution integrated with the service mesh solution. So this is how WSO2 API manager service mesh solution looks like with this tier. So same way we had before. We have Envoy proxy along in the microservices A. So only difference now is like, so I show you before, whenever request comes to microservices A, it handles incoming request and it communicates with the mixer, and mixer has adapter mechanism. So what we did was we utilized this extendable adapter architecture, and we implement WSO2 API manager specific adapter, which communicates with the API management layer. So basically what we are calling that is the management layer or API management layer. So in addition to control plane, we will have different level, which is called API management plane, which handles all the API metadata, API data summarization, and other throttling and all other information related to them. So basically that doesn't handle the runtime part, it mainly handles the metadata and the basic information about the API. So with this adapter, you don't have to touch existing Envoy services or any of your deployment. So some of the solutions that we have today require us to, you know, deploy certain components to the Envoy proxy, or sometimes we have to change the mixer, or they are kind of different thing. But with this particular solution, you will not need to modify the Envoy proxy, you will not have to modify the mixer. So it's just you have to have this deploy mixer adapter and link that with the mixer. So if you already have a service mesh solution within your organization, this would be very, it should be very easy for you to integrate with the WSO2 API management. So just add one node, which is mixture adapter, and it communicates with the mixture and the API management solution. So it's a very simple solution. And also if we take deployment, it's again very easy. And also it's very powerful. So now if we go back to the previous image that I showed you, you can see we had all components here. So only change what we are doing here is this particular WSO2 mixture adapter plugin here, and it will communicate with the API management. So with this, you will get all the advantages that you have with the API management solution. Okay. So I think with this, we cover a basic overview about the feature and what this feature is all about. So next, what we plan to do is to have a demo session. So with this demo, we will see how discussed topics that we can, how we can apply them practically, how we can deploy these components and other stuff. So with me, I have Nadisha Gamge, who is a senior technical lead at WSO2. So let me hand over session to him. Over to you, Nadisha.
Thank you, Sanjeeva. Hi, everyone. So I'll quickly move on to the demo. So I have, at the moment, Istio deployment running on Google Kubernetes engine. So let me log into the shell of that engine and do the rest of the demo sometime. So what I have so far is Istio deployment running, and I have a service that is deployed on Istio. So to start the demo, what I'll do is I'll invoke this service directly without deploying any of the API management artifacts to Istio. So let me select the right API. So if I make a call to Istio, which is the service is called the current time service, which calls Istio would route the call to a service that is running on the internet. It will give you the current time of a given location. So if I make a call, it goes through without a problem. So that's what is there right now. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to let you know what are the steps that I'm going to follow. So initially, what I'm going to do is there's two parts to this. There is the API management component, where you would do the standard creation and publishing of an API. You would create an application and then make a subscription to that API. Finally, you will generate a token associated with the application to invoke the API that you just subscribed to. So there are four steps involved in the API manager part of things. And then if you look at the Istio part of things, there are two main tasks. The first one is we will deploy a mixer adapter to Istio. And then there are a few related files that come with the mixer adapter, which actually tells what are the configurations that are associated with the mixer adapter. We will deploy that configuration. Secondly, we will deploy a rule and a bind file. The rule will define what kind of requests or what kind of services should be exposed to this particular rule. And then there's a bind file which will let you, or which will tell Istio on the fine-grained authentication enforcement that needs to be done for the APIs that are going to be exposed. The rule file is a single file that we will deploy, but bind file will have each API will have a bind file instance. So for example, if you have 10 APIs exposed, you would have 10 separate bind files for these APIs. Finally, once you set up all of these things, you will invoke the API and you should be able to access the API through Istio, and Istio would make relevant authorization to check whether the API is authorized or the user is authorized to access that API, and grant or deny access based on the authorization rule that we've set at Istio. So all these rules will be managed and pushed by the WSO2 API manager. Okay, so just to give a bit of a technical overview of what are the artifacts that are being that will be deployed. So this is an extension of what Sanjeev explained. You would have your pilot, Citadel and Mixer already running. But we will additionally add is the WS2 Mixer adapter, which is indicated here. As I mentioned, there are multiple config files that are associated with the Mixer adapter. There's an adapter config file which defines how you would connect with the WS2 API manager. We will also add an API manager public certificate to this Mixer adapter so that JWT tokens can be the signature of the JWT token can be validated based on this public certificate. To the Mixer, we will add a Mixer adapter connectivity config, which will let the Mixer know what config that it should use to connect to the Mixer adapter, which is running separately. Then we will define our rule to the Mixer, which will define what kind of APIs should the rule apply to. So that's what is in the Mixer. And in the pilot, we will add an API bind file, which will tell you, or which will tell Istio what will be the fine-grain authorization rules that should be applied to the APIs that have been exposed. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to deploy all these artifacts to my Istio deployment. What I'm going to do first is I'm going to start with the Mixer. Let me copy the command and execute the command here. This again. So I'm going to deploy the Mixer to the Istio deployment. So it will deploy all the Mixer related files as well as all the configuration files associated with the Mixer plugin of the API manager Mixer plugin that we will deploy. So all the configs and related files will be deployed at the same time. Next, what I'm going to do is I'm going to deploy my bind file. Let me copy this and deploy this. At the same time, I'll open the bind file so you can see what is the content of that bind file. So as you could see, the bind file will tell you what is the name of the API, what is the version of the API, and what kind of API context should this rule be applied to. And then you would have you would define what kind of a job scope should be enforced on a given URL pattern. So if you have four patterns, you will have all the four patterns defined here, and each will have its own job scope defined in this particular bind file. So my bind file is also deployed now to Istio. What I will do next is I will deploy my rule again to Istio. Copy the rule. Deploy. Until it deploys, I'll open the rule file and show what is the content of the rule file. So if you check the rule file, so rule file will define what kind of traffic this rule should apply to and what kind of namespace that it should apply to. So that is defined at this point. So my rule file is also deployed to Istio. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to go to Postman and call the same API that I called earlier and then try to access that. And then the Istio would provide me an error saying that my credentials are missing because I'm required to pass a JWT token in order to access this API now because I have applied the rule as well as the bind file to Istio. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to deploy, create and publish an API in the API manager. So this is our API manager publisher user interface. So I'm logged in as admin to our publisher. Let me re-log in. Okay. So now I'm logged in to the publisher. You could see what are the APIs available. We do provide a UI-based user interface where you could create an API. Alternatively, there's a RESTful API that you can invoke to create an API. So given that we are short of time, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the REST interface to create an API in the API manager. So in order to do that, I'm going to generate a token to push an API in. So let me generate a token first, copy that token, and then call the API creation API. Let me copy this again. Now it should go through. Let me copy this again.
So there's feedback.
Let me look this. This should work. So API is now created, and if I go to the API publisher, you would see the time API being created in the API publisher, and it's in the created state. So what I'm going to do next is click on this API and then change the lifecycle of the API to published. I can, let me zoom in the screen also that you can see it clearly. So I'm going to publish this API. And then I will, the state will be updated as published. And if I go to the overview, you will see the API being marked as published. So that's the task of the of creating and publishing an API. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to move to the developer portal of the API manager, which can be accessed from the store URL. Developer portal allows you to has the option of self sign up if required. At the moment, I have an account already created, so I'm going to use that account to log into the API store. Once inside, I will see all the APIs that are available. So this is my newly created API. So let me click on this. Under that, I can see what are the resources that have been exposed by this API. If you want to add any documentation, you can upload it from the publisher, and any subscriber would see the documentation here. There's a lightweight forum available where developers can come and discuss on different aspects of APIs through the forum. Okay. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to go and create an application to generate a token and subscribe to this API. And I'm going to add an application. Let me call this JWT application. This application would have a JOT token associated to it. Looking at that. So the application is created now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to the API and subscribe to this API. Click on Time API. Select my newly created JOT application. And then make a subscription. So my subscription is successful. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to view the subscription. See my API has been subscribed. And I will generate a token for this API. So when generating a token, I will define the scope that I want. The scope that I need to include in the JWT token, and then I will click on that scope and generate a key. So API manager will generate a JOT token for me to invoke the API. So let me copy this token, go to my API and include it in the header. Let me enable this and invoke the API now. So now now what happens is the token has the scope associated to it has, it tells what are the APIs that I can access with that token, and when I pass the token along with the request in the header, the envoy will validate the content of the token, check the validity of the signature, and then deny or allow access to an API using that particular token. So if I move back to my slide, so if I browse through the content of the token, you would have a scope associated to the token. This retrieve time will be part of the scope. And if you look at the subscribed API component, you would have the name of the API, you would have the context of the API and the API version, all being part or embedded in the token. So that allows the envoy to make a decision in terms of whether it should allow or deny access to a given API. So the second scenario that I want to show is standard OAuth2 token. So the difference here is that earlier WSO MixAdapter itself validated the token. In this case, what happens is MixAdapter will communicate with the API manager, and the API manager would be the policy decision point, and it will pass the decision back to the MixAdapter to enforce or to allow access or deny access to a given API. So what is passed to the MixAdapter, from MixAdapter to API manager, is the API context, the version, the token itself, and few other information that allows the API manager to make the decision whether to allow or deny access to this particular API. So what I'm going to do now is create a new application in API manager. Go back. Let me create an application called OAuth2 app. We should have OAuth token. Once app is created, I'm going to do the same step. I'm going to go to my APIs, click on the time API. Click the OAuth2 app and make a subscription. So what I'm going to do is subscription is successful. So I'm going to go to production keys, and this time I'm going to generate a OAuth2 token, which will include the retrieve time scope. So once I generate, I will be given an OAuth2 token, which I can use to invoke the API. Same way, this time rather than the JOT, I will have the OAuth2 token included here. And I will make the invocation. Again, MixAdapter will pass the information. Gateway will, the API manager will make the decision whether it should allow or deny and pass it back to Istio so that it can grant or deny access to a given API. So if I add some random characters to this token, it should deny me from accessing the API, initialing that the token is not valid. So those are the two scenarios that I want to demonstrate. So what we have in store for our upcoming release is the support for analytics process. The release, the product, the feature will be released, is planned to release today. What this will do is it will push analytics data to WS2 API analytics, which will allow users to see statistics on dashboards. So you will have multiple a gamut of statistics or dashboards that are available to show different types of statistics that are available, mostly business related statistics that are not captured by default by Istio. So all that is available through the API manager. Finally, I want to give a brief overview of how the development has gone so far and what is our roadmap. So we've been rapidly developing this feature. We did our first release on March 29th, which was 0.5, which had just JWT and API subscription validation capability. The demo was done based on version 0.6, which was released on April 5th, which had OAuth2 support also added to it. Today we are planning to release API analytics integration, which is marked as 0.8 version. And by the end of the month, we will have a 1.0 version release, which has first-class integration with Istio. All the bind files will be automatically created from API manager and pushed to Istio without manually you having to deploy them through a command line. So what is coming afterwards is monetization of usage, which will be aligned with upcoming releases of API manager product itself. And then we also have plans to integrate throttling and rate limiting also, where we can enforce throttling and rate limiting from API manager, and Envoy would enforce those throttling and rate limit policies that are being exposed from the API manager. So that's what is going to come up in future in terms of Istio development roadmap. So that concludes the demo.